Want to speak real Greek from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at GreekPod101.com.
Hi everyone, this is Stefania. Welcome to another Greek Top Words video. In this video, you'll learn 10 phrases you never want to hear. These are the kind of phrases that probably tick you off and make you roll your eyes so much that they'll end up behind your neck, reach your back, and maybe they'll keep rolling and leave the room. Okay, that was too much. Without further ado, here are the 10 phrases you never want to hear. Έχεις πάρει κιλά τώρα τελευταία? Have you gained weight recently? Έχεις πάρει κιλά τώρα τελευταία? Have you gained weight recently? Some things are better left unsaid, and that's one of them. Έχεις μια άσπρη τρίχα. You have a gray hair. Έχεις μια άσπρη τρίχα. You have a gray hair. It's comments like this that make you feel so old. But you shouldn't, because deep down inside, you're young at heart. Everyone is young at heart, right? It's just one white hair. It doesn't mean anything. It means you're getting wiser, right? You're getting wiser. It's all about perspective, I guess. Next. Σου το είπα. I told you so. Σου το είπα. I told you so. This can also be pronounced στόπα, with the pronoun σου and the verb form είπα contracted. To further complement this variety, this phrase can also come in a wide variety of voice tones, each more annoying than the other. Σου το είπα. Σου το είπα. Σου το είπα. Στόπα. Απολύεσαι. You're fired. And this is the absolute worst, I think. Απολύεσαι. You're fired. This also comes in a variety of voice tones, depending on how much you've angered your boss. Απολύεσαι. 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 Δεν έχει να κάνει με σένα. Έχει να κάνει με μένα. It's not you, it is me. Δεν έχει να κάνει με σένα, έχει να κάνει με μένα. It's not you, it is me. Okay, breaking up sucks, so does this line. I think most of the times, not always of course, people mean exactly the opposite, but use this line in order not to hurt the other person, which is considerate of course, but not too honest.
Σας ευχαριστούμε για το βιογραφικό σας. Η θέση όμως έχει καταληφθεί.
Thank you for your resume. However, the position has been filled.
Σας ευχαριστούμε για το βιογραφικό σας. Η θέση όμως έχει καταληφθεί.
Thank you for your resume. However, the position has been filled. Here, the word βιογραφικό sounds similar to the word βιογραφία, which means biography. So don't confuse the two. Βιογραφικό refers only to a resume.
Πρέπει να αρχίσουμε να βγαίνουμε με άλλους.
We should see other people.
Πρέπει να αρχίσουμε να βγαίνουμε με άλλους.
We should see other people. Literally, we should start dating other people. Another breakup line you don't want to hear. Or maybe you do. If you're not happy in a relationship, it could work both ways.
Δεν έχω τα λεφτά σου σήμερα.
I don't have your money today.
Δεν έχω τα λεφτά σου σήμερα.
I don't have your money today.
Show me the money!
It's from Jerry Maguire. I love that Jerry Maguire scene with Tom Cruise. Show me the money! Show me the money!
Πρέπει να μιλήσουμε.
We have to talk.
Πρέπει να μιλήσουμε.
We need to talk. That always smells like trouble ahead. It's definitely not talking about what's for dinner tonight. So if you hear it,
καλή τύχη.
Good luck.
Συγγνώμη, το ξέχασα.
Sorry, I forgot it.
Συγγνώμη, το ξέχασα.
Sorry, I forgot. In very casual situations, Greeks also say sorry instead of συγγνώμη.
Sorry. Oops, sorry. Sorry, το ξέχασα.
Use sorry only with friends and family. Otherwise, go for the safest option. Συγγνώμη. Συγγνώμη, το ξέχασα. You've reached the end of this video. I hope you liked it. Can you think of some other phrases that you don't want to hear? You can leave them in the comments below. And if you want to watch more videos like this, check out GreekPod101.com and subscribe to our YouTube channel. See you in the next video. Γεια χαρά!
Hi everybody, Stefania here. Welcome to Ask a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Greek questions. The question for this lesson is, how can I tell if a noun is masculine, feminine, or neuter? I get this question all the time. If the noun is in its dictionary form, in other words, in the nominative case, and is accompanied by a definite or indefinite article, then the article will indicate the noun's gender. Now, if the noun is not accompanied by an article, and especially when it is in an inflected form, then the gender might not be obvious. However, if you become familiar with the most common noun endings and declension patterns, you should be able to tell the gender in most cases. Let's get into more detail. First, let's see what are the most common masculine, feminine, and neuter noun endings. The following endings are the most common masculine endings in the nominative case. Os like ilios, sun. As like pateras, father. Is like mathitis, student. Es like cafes, coffee. Us like papus, grandfather. And eas like kureas, barber. Some common feminine nouns have the following endings in the nominative case. Os like odos, street. A like mitera, mother. E like agapi, love. U like maimou, monkey. And o like icho, echo. The following endings are the most common neuter endings in the nominative case. Os like dasos, forest. O like nero, water. E like pedi, child. Ma like pragma, thing. Imo like grapsimo, writing. Sigma like fos, light. And ni like parelthon, past. Here are some sample sentences. Ο πατέρας και η μητέρα παίζουν με το παιδί τους. The father and the mother are playing with their child. Ο τουρίστας φωτογραφίζει μια μαϊμού στο δάσος. The tourist is taking pictures of a monkey in the forest. To follow this up, how can you tell the gender of os ending nouns? As you've noticed, the os ending can be found in nouns of all genders. So when you see this, you can't really guess the gender if there is no article or another helpful word around. However, here's a tip. If the noun is accented in the last syllable, you can be sure that this noun is not neuter. Another important thing to know is that there are many os ending nouns that are both masculine and feminine. Those usually denote a profession, such as o I γιατρός, doctor, or o I δικηγόρος, lawyer. Let's see some examples. Η γιατρός παρατηρεί τις ακτινογραφίες. The doctor is observing the x-rays. Ο δικηγόρος μιλάει στον δικαστή. The lawyer is speaking to the judge. Finally, what are some uncommon noun endings? There are only a few specific native Greek nouns that have uncommon endings, like the irregular masculine noun mis, muscle, ending in is, the neuter ipar, liver, and pir, fire, that end in ro, the neuter gala, milk, that ends in a, and the neuter oxy, acid, dori, spare, and imisi, half, that end in ypsilon. Also, the names of the letters of the alphabet are all neuter nouns, even the ones that end in a, like alpha and vita. Finally, there are many long words that have not been adapted to the Greek declension system, so they don't get inflected, and they usually have uncommon or confusing endings, like the dual-gender indeclinable noun detective, ending in vita. So long words will always be more challenging when it comes to guessing the gender. Here are two more examples. Το μωρό πίνει πολύ γάλα. The baby drinks a lot of milk. Οι detective παρακολουθούν έναν ύποπτο. The detectives are following a suspect. I'm sure after a lesson like this, you might be freaking out. But if you're a beginner or an absolute beginner, you don't need to know all of this right away. A tip that will make your life easier down the road is when you study vocabulary, focus on the endings of words and always, always memorize declinable words together with their articles, especially nouns. Do that at least for the os ending nouns or other nouns you feel you might get confused. Don't just memorize milk as gala. You should memorize it as το γάλα. Otherwise, you might mistake it for a feminine noun because it ends in a. How was the lesson? Pretty interesting, right? Do you have any more questions? Leave them in the comments below and I'll try to answer them. Γεια χαρά!
Hi everyone, I'm Stefania from GreekPod101.com. Do you know how to say I love you in Greek? In this lesson, you'll learn three different ways to say I love you and a special phrase for Valentine's Day. Let's start with the most common phrase. Σ' αγαπώ. Σ' αγαπώ. I love you. This phrase is direct. You should use it only when you're confessing your love. If you want to be less direct, you can use this phrase. Σημαίνεις τόσα πολλά για μένα. Σημαίνεις τόσα πολλά για μένα. It means you mean so much to me. What if you want to be more romantic in expressing your love for someone? Here's the phrase for you. Οι λέξεις δεν μπορούν να περιγράψουν την αγάπη μου για σένα. Οι λέξεις δεν μπορούν να περιγράψουν την αγάπη μου για σένα. It means words cannot describe my love for you. Now you know three different ways to say I love you in Greek. And here's one more. What if you want to spend Valentine's Day with someone special? In that case, you can say Θες να γίνεις ο Βαλεντίνος μου. Θες να γίνεις ο Βαλεντίνος μου. This means, will you be my Valentine? Okay, let's wrap up this lesson by recapping what we've learned. Listen to the expression and repeat after me. I love you. Σ' αγαπώ. Σ' αγαπώ. You mean so much to me. Σημαίνεις τόσα πολλά για μένα. Σημαίνεις τόσα πολλά για μένα. Words can't describe my love for you. Οι λέξεις δεν μπορούν να περιγράψουν την αγάπη μου για σένα. Οι λέξεις δεν μπορούν να περιγράψουν την αγάπη μου για σένα. Will you be my Valentine? Θες να γίνεις ο Βαλεντίνος μου. Θες να γίνεις ο Βαλεντίνος μου. Well done! Here's a fun fact. Do you know the god who represents love in Greek mythology? The god Eros is the wing god of love. The English word erotic is from his Greek name Eros. Eros made people fall madly in love by striking them with his arrows. Usually he is depicted nude as a handsome young man or a chubby child, holding a bow and arrows. You just learned three different ways to say I love you in Greek and one special phrase for Valentine's Day. I'll see you next time! Γεια χαρά! Hi everyone, this is Stefania and in this video you'll learn 10 phrases you always want to hear. We all need to hear some good words from time to time, a compliment or a motivational comment, so why not learn these phrases and spread some smiles around you? Let's start. Φαίνεσαι καταπληκτικός σήμερα. You look great today. Φαίνεσαι καταπληκτικός σήμερα. You look great today. This is a phrase to use when you refer to a man. When you refer to a woman, you should say Φαίνεσαι καταπληκτική σήμερα. Μου λείπεις. I miss you. Μου λείπεις. I miss you. Be careful if you want to use this one-on-one with a friend. This might be taken the wrong way, as it sounds like an expression of your love feelings for someone. If you want to say to a close friend that you miss him or her, try to make it more neutral by adding something in the end. For example, for a man you can say something like Μου λείπεις, ρεκολητέ. I miss you, buddy. Or Μου λείπεις, φίλε μου. I miss you, my friend. And for a woman you can say Μου λείπεις, ρε φιλενάδα. I miss you, girlfriend. Or Μου λείπεις, φίλη μου. I miss you, my friend. Or even Μου λείπεις, ρε κορίτσι. I miss you, girl. Of course, in plural, there's no chance people will receive it as a love feeling expression. Έκανες σπουδαία δουλειά. You did a great job. Έκανες σπουδαία δουλειά. You did a great job. Θα υπάρχει ένα bonus στο τέλος του μήνα. There will be a bonus at the end of the month. Θα υπάρχει ένα bonus στο τέλος του μήνα. There will be a bonus at the end of the month. Sweet. Είσαι ένας εξαιρετικός μάγειρας. You're an excellent cook. Είσαι ένας εξαιρετικός μάγειρας. You're an excellent cook. Again, this is for a male listener. If you are talking to a woman, you should say Είσαι μια εξαιρετική μαγείρισα. Κάνε ένα διάλειμμα, θα καθαρίσω εγώ σήμερα. Take a break. I'll do the cleaning today. Κάνε ένα διάλειμμα, θα καθαρίσω εγώ σήμερα. Take a break. I'll do the cleaning today. Don't mind if I do. Κέρδισες. You won. Κέρδισες. You won. Now that's something I like to hear. Especially if that's about the lottery. Ka-ching! Είχες δίκιο. You were right. Είχες δίκιο. You were right. An answer to this could be Το ξέρω. I know. Σου έφερα κάτι ιδιαίτερο. I brought you something special. Σου έφερα κάτι ιδιαίτερο. I brought you something special. Well, that depends on what's special for you. Bravo. Well done. Bravo. Well done. This is borrowed from Italian, but in Greek we don't distinguish male from female for bravo, like Italians do with bravo and brava. It's always bravo in Greek, regardless of the number and gender of people it refers to. And that's it for the 10 phrases you always want to hear. Do you have any other phrases that you would like to hear? Let me know in the comments below. And if you like this video, give it a thumbs up, subscribe, and stay tuned on GreekPod101.com for more videos like this.
Hi everybody, Stefania here. Welcome to Ask a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Greek questions. The question for this lesson is, when do you use iota, ita, ypsilon, epsilon iota, omicron iota, and ypsilon iota? At the very beginning, the proper spelling of Greek words is something that has to be learned and memorized in the same way that you learned how to spell words in your own language. You need exposure and lots of practice. For example, in English, you memorize that it is tree and not tree, and it's T and not T. In Greek, though, things become somewhat easier as you gain knowledge of declensions and conjugations, especially when that E sound is at the end of an inflected word. Let's get into more detail. First, let's see what you have to know if that E sound is at the end of a word. Inflected words in Greek, such as articles, nouns, adjectives, and verbs, usually follow specific ending patterns when inflected. If you know the patterns, then the E sound at the end of such words is predictable. Here are a few generally safe rules. Number one, the plural forms of masculine and feminine os-ending nouns, as well as masculine os-ending adjectives and pronouns, will end in omicron iota. For example, η ψήφοι καταμετρώνται από την επιτροπή means the votes are being counted by the committee. Number two, words that end in ita are mainly feminine nouns and pronouns in the singular form and the plural form of neuter os-ending nouns. Number three, words that end in iota are usually neuter nouns. For example, Το σκυλί σκάβει λάκκους στον κήπο. Means the dog is digging up holes in the garden. Number 4. The verb forms that have an e sound in the ending will be spelled with epsilon iota. The verb pliro, to fulfill, however, is an exception, as its e endings are spelled with omicron iota. Following up, what about ypsilon and ypsilon iota? The double vowel combination ypsilon iota is very rare, and it's not something you'll find at the end of a word. It's only used in the word ios, meaning sun, and its derivatives. For example, ikos, of or related to a son, iothesia or iothetisi, adoption, iotheto, to adopt, and iothetimenos, iothetimeni, iothetimeno, adopted. As for the words that have an ypsilon in the ending that is not part of the u, av, or ev sounds, they are also not that many, so they can be easily learned. The most common ones are the is-ending adjectives like vathis, deep, varis, heavy or strong, elafris, light, ephthis, straight, makris, long, pachis, thick or fat, and polis, much or many, among others. Some nouns like asti, city, vradi, night, mis, muscle, dakri, tear, dichti, net, ischis, force, oxy, acid, and stachi, cob. Some adverbs like andikri or katandikri, opposite, metaxi, between, anametaxi, among, and poli, very or too much, or a lot. The pronoun esi, you. And finally, some foreign names like Sisi, Freddy, Vicky, and so on. Here are some sample sentences using words that are spelled with ypsilon. Το βράδυ κάνει κρύο. At night, it's cold. Ο καφές είναι πολύ βαρύς. The coffee is very strong. Finally, what if the e sound is not at the end of a word? In that case, you need to focus on the root or the roots of compound words, because the root might remind you of words you already know. For example, if you know how to spell ipsos, height, then all the words that begin with ipsos will be spelled with ypsilon at the beginning. For example, ipsometro, altitude, ipsilos, tall or high, ipsipedo, highland, ipsoma, elevation, ipsono, to raise, etc. Here are some sample sentences. Το χωριό βρίσκεται σε υψόμετρο 2,000 μέτρων. The village is located at an altitude of 2,000 meters. Μη μου υψώνεις τη φωνή. Don't you raise your voice at me. However, there will always be times that you will simply have no idea how to correctly spell a word you hear. Memorization will always be part of the learning process. It's just something that you shouldn't get too frustrated about. Write as much and as best as you can without feeling ashamed, even when you know you might be making a lot of mistakes. With enough time, practice and study, you can and will perfect your spelling. How was the lesson? Pretty interesting, right? Do you have any more questions? Leave them in the comments below and I'll try to answer them. Γεια χαρά!
Hi everyone, Stefania here. Welcome to another video where I'll teach you 10 phrases to amaze native speakers. Let's start. Είναι διασκεδαστικό και εύκολο το να μάθεις ελληνικά. Greek is fun and easy to learn. Είναι διασκεδαστικό και εύκολο το να μάθεις ελληνικά. Greek is fun and easy to learn. I don't think Greek is an easy language to learn, but if you do, then good for you. Εκτός από τα ελληνικά, μιλάω και μερικές άλλες γλώσσες επίσης. Apart from knowing Greek, I can speak a few other languages as well. Εκτός από τα ελληνικά, μιλάω και μερικές άλλες γλώσσες επίσης. Apart from knowing Greek, I can speak a few other languages as well. For example, you can say μιλάω αγγλικά και ισπανικά. I speak English and Spanish. Some other languages are Πορτογαλικά for Portuguese, Ιταλικά for Italian, Γερμανικά for German, Ρωσικά for Russian,
Arabica for Arabic and Kinesica for Chinese. These are just a few examples. If you want to know how to say your language in Greek, just leave a comment below.
Κατάλαβα εντελώς όλα όσα είπες.
I completely understood everything you said. The next phrase is
Κατάλαβα εντελώς όλα όσα είπες.
I completely understood everything you said. In this sentence, you can also skip εντελώς and say
Κατάλαβα όλα όσα είπες.
I understood everything you said.
Μαθαίνω ελληνικά εδώ και 10 χρόνια.
I've been learning Greek for 10 years.
Μαθαίνω ελληνικά εδώ και 10 χρόνια.
I've been learning Greek for 10 years. Although 10 years sounds like too much, I think it is not an unusual amount of time to reach fluency in Greek. I think it took me 8 to 9 years during my school years to learn English, which I considered an easier language than Greek. And all that while I was getting a lot of exposure to English through music and movies. Perhaps you don't know that, but in Greece, foreign movies and shows never get dubbed. They get subtitles unless they are intended for very young audiences. So you can always hear English on the TV or on the radio. If I remember correctly, for most of my school years, I was doing lessons once or twice a week. Maybe if I had done a super intensive course, like every day for 4 to 5 hours, I would have learned much faster. My point is that if you want to reach Greek fluency, you need to dedicate a lot of time one way or the other.
Μαθαίνω ελληνικά μόνος μου.
I'm learning Greek all by myself. Let's move on to the next phrase.
Μαθαίνω ελληνικά μόνος μου.
I'm learning Greek all by myself. If you're a woman, you can say Μαθαίνω ελληνικά μόνη μου. I don't think I could ever learn a language μόνη μου. I like being in a class with a teacher and classmates. But some people manage to learn things on their own, which is amazing. I wish I had the discipline it takes to do that. There's so many languages I would like to learn.
Μου πήρε μόνο έναν χρόνο για να μάθω να μιλάω άπτεστα.
It took me only 1 year to become fluent.
Μου πήρε μόνο έναν χρόνο για να μάθω να μιλάω άπτεστα.
It took me only 1 year to become fluent. People will get very impressed for sure if you manage to do that. We Greeks consider our language to be quite difficult to learn.
Μπορώ και αποστηθίζω γύρω στις 50 νέες ελληνικές λέξεις την ημέρα.
I can memorize around 50 new Greek words a day.
Μπορώ και αποστηθίζω γύρω στις 50 νέες ελληνικές λέξεις την ημέρα.
I can memorize around 50 new Greek words a day. That is a lot.
Μπορώ να βλέπω ελληνικές ταινίες χωρίς υπότιτλους.
I can watch Greek movies without subtitles.
Μπορώ να βλέπω ελληνικές ταινίες χωρίς υπότιτλους.
I can watch Greek movies without subtitles. If you can do that, then congratulations, you are fluent, my friend, and you don't need me anymore.
Σε 3 χρόνια θα μιλάω ελληνικά σαν να ήταν η μητρική μου γλώσσα.
I'll speak Greek like a native speaker in 3 years.
Σε 3 χρόνια θα μιλάω ελληνικά σαν να ήταν η μητρική μου γλώσσα.
I'll speak Greek like a native speaker in 3 years. Sounds like a big challenge. You think you can do it?
Έχω μάθει να τραγουδάω τον εθνικό ύμνο.
I learned how to sing the Greek national anthem.
Έχω μάθει να τραγουδάω τον εθνικό ύμνο.
I learned how to sing the Greek national anthem. Do you know the title of the Greek national anthem? It's called Ύμνος εις την ελευθερία, meaning hymn to liberty or hymn to freedom. And it was written by the poet Dionysios Solomos. and was put to music by Nikolaos Mandzaros. When sung, the anthem consists of two stanzas, or verses as they call it in music. Although normally the poem consists of 158 stanzas, making it the longest in-text national anthem in the world. I bet you didn't know that. So there you have it! 10 phrases to amaze native speakers. I hope you found the lesson interesting. Can you think of some other phrases that could amaze a Greek? If you do, leave them in the comments below. And if you like this video, give it a thumbs up, subscribe to our channel, and visit GreekPod101.com to learn more. Γεια χαρά!
You've decided to study a new language, so now what? Well, you want to become fluent fast, right? Here are the top 5 shortcuts to learning a language. Number 1. Create a study schedule and set some goals. Many language learners are unorganized. Creating a schedule allows you to free up time to study consistently. Goals give you motivation and something to strive for. Number 2. Make it fun. If you learn how to make your study time enjoyable, chances are you'll be more inclined to study. Watch a TV show with subtitles or listen to some music. Number 3. Find a language partner. This is the best way to improve your conversation skills. It will help you gain fluency even faster and increase confidence when speaking. Number 4. Use word lists to build up a solid vocabulary. This is a great way to build up your fluency, one word at a time. Luckily, we have all the word lists you need, with a range of topics, from food to love. Choose whichever language you want to study and go. Number 5. Don't be afraid to make mistakes. Nothing helps you improve more than correcting your own errors. You're more likely to remember it correctly the next time around. Everyone makes mistakes. Don't be afraid to learn from them. There's no magical way to learn a new language overnight, but doing all of these can really help your learning process. And remember, if you're interested in getting on the fast track to fluency, sign up for your free lifetime account. No credit card required, and you'll get the best free online resources. Start learning now.
Hi everybody, Stefania here. Welcome to Ask a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Greek questions. The question for this lesson is, when do you use omicron and omega? Like I mentioned in the previous video, spelling Greek words correctly requires memorization in combination with constant exposure to vocabulary and lots of practice. Since Greek has two different letters for the same O sound, let's see in what words you are most likely to see each one. We will be focusing only on the endings of inflected words though, since things there are easier if you have some basic knowledge of declension and conjugation. Let's get into more detail. First, let's see which words have omicron in their ending. The biggest category here are the O ending masculine pronouns and adjectives, and nouns of all genders. For example, αυτός, he, ο καθαρός, clean, ο βράχος, rock, η οδός, street, and το χάος, chaos. There are a few neuter nouns, though, that are spelled with omega instead, such as το καθεστώς, regime, το φως, light, το ημίφος, semi-darkness, and το λυκόφος, twilight. Here are some sample sentences. Ο δάσκαλος ξενυχτάει διορθώνοντας γραπτά. The teacher stays up late correcting tests. Ο κρύος καιρός συνεχίζεται. The cold weather continues. Other words that have omicron in their ending are O ending neuter pronouns, nouns, and adjectives like πιο, which, ποτό, drink, and καλό, good. On-ending neuter nouns and adjectives like παρόν, present, and ενδιαφέρον, interesting. Onas-ending masculine adjectives like μετριόφρονας, mediocre. Imo-ending neuter nouns such as βάψιμο, coloring or painting. All those os-ending singular genitive forms of pronouns, nouns, and adjectives such as του πράγματος, of the thing. του απόντος, of the absent, and κανενός, of no one. Exceptions are some of the e-ending feminine nouns that form the singular genitive in eos with omega, such as η γνώση, knowledge, that becomes της γνώσεως. All the verbs ending in a non-accented ome in the passive voice, such as σέβομαι, to respect. All the gerunds ending in a non-accented ondas, such as τρέχοντας, running. And the number δύο, two. Finally, the words that have omega in their ending are the pronoun εγώ, I, the number οκτώ or οκτώ, eight, the o-ending feminine nouns such as πειθώ, persuasion, ηχώ, echo, φιδώ, thriftiness, and names such as κλειώ, ερατώ, ηρώ, αργυρώ, βασίλω, δέσπο, μάρο, βαγγελιώ, κατερινιώ, φρόσο, etc. The on-ending masculine and feminine adjectives such as ο, ή, ευγνώμων, thankful. All the plural genitive forms of declinable words such as αυτών, of them, των παιδιών, children's, των όμορφων, of the beautiful. The os-ending adverbs like ευτυχώς, luckily. All the verbs ending in an accent ome in the passive voice, such as εγιώμε, to guarantee. All the gerunds ending in an accented ondas, such as ζητώντας, asking. And finally, all the verbs that can be formed in the active voice will end in omega in the first person of the present tense. For example, παίζω, to play, μετράω, to count, and κολυμπώ, to swim. Here are some sample sentences. Δυστυχώς η Φρόσο και εγώ μαλώνουμε συνέχεια. Unfortunately, Φρόσο and I fight all the time. Μπορώ να μετράω ως το 10 σε 8 γλώσσες. I can count to 10 in 8 languages. The general rules I've mentioned refer mostly to the dictionary forms of words. The inflected forms have a variety of endings, so it will always be necessary for you to know the declension and conjugation groups and the patterns of their endings. I hope this lesson was helpful and not too difficult or confusing. Do you have any more questions? Leave them in the comments below, and I'll try to answer them. Γεια χαρά!
Welcome to Greek Pod 101, and I am Emmanuel, and I will be your teacher for today. So today we'll learn 10 ways to save the planet in Greek. Ανακυκλώνω. Recycle. Στο γραφείο μας ανακυκλώνουμε τα άχρηστα χαρτιά. In our office, we recycle the useless papers. Εθελοντής. Volunteer. Είμαι εθελοντής σε μια οργάνωση για την προστασία της θαλάσσιας χελώνας. I'm volunteer at an organization for the protection of the sea turtle. Προστατεύω. Protect. Το σύστημα αυτό προστατεύει το δάσος από τις πυρκαγιές. This system protects the forest from wildfires. Επαναχρησιμοποιώ. Reuse. I know this is very difficult. Συνηθίζω να επαναχρησιμοποιώ τις πλαστικές σακούλες. I tend to reuse the plastic bags. Διατηρώ. To conserve. Το δάσος διατηρείται με τη βοήθεια των δασοφυλάκων. The forest is conserved with the help of forest rangers. Κάνω οικονομία στο νερό. To save water. Κλείνε τη βρύση όταν βουρτσίζεις τα δόντια σου για να κάνεις οικονομία στο νερό. Turn off the tap when you brush your teeth to save water. Νοιάζομαι για το περιβάλλον. I care for the environment. Οι κάτοικοι του χωριού αυτού νοιάζονται για το περιβάλλον και το προστατεύουν. The inhabitants of this village care for the environment and protect it. Χρησιμοποιώ ποδήλατο. Use the bicycle. Χρησιμοποιεί ποδήλατο για να πηγαίνει στη δουλειά. He uses the bicycle to go to work. Χρησιμοποιώ βιοδιασπόμενα προϊόντα. To use biodegradable products. Για το καθαρισμό του σπιτιού χρησιμοποιούμε βιοδιασπόμενα προϊόντα. We use biodegradable products for cleaning the house. Φυτεύω δέντρα. Plant trees. Οι μαθητές σήμερα πρόκειται να φυτέψουν δέντρα στο δάσος. The students today are going to plant trees in the forest. So, this is for today. Hope you like it. If you want to learn more about Greek language, you can visit GreekPod101.com and you can subscribe to the channel. Have a nice day and see you soon. Take care.
Hi everybody, Stefania here. Welcome to Ask a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Greek questions. The question for this lesson is, how do you use Greek definite articles? Just like in English, we use Greek definite articles to talk about specific people, animals, things, or concepts, so they need to be defined. Greek has three different definite articles, o, I, and to, for the masculine, feminine, and neuter genders respectively. They are inflected, so their forms can change. An article defines a noun and it needs to always agree with it in gender, number, and case. However, instead of a noun, we could use any nominalized word or phrase to act like a noun. Let's go into more detail. First, let's see when we use the Greek definite articles. In Greek, we use them more often than their English equivalent, the. So while in English we say, I like tennis, in Greek we say, μου αρέσει το tennis, literally, I like the tennis, because we are specifying which sport we like. We even use articles in front of days of the week, months, years, festivals, seasons, and proper names of places or people. For example, ο Γιάννης είναι εδώ. The John is here. However, when we address that person directly, we don't use an article and we form the name in the vocative case. For example, Γιάννη, έλα εδώ. John, come here. Notice how Γιάννης in the nominative case changed to Γιάννη in the vocative case. Here are some sample sentences. Ποιος είναι? Η Μαρία. Who is it? It's Maria. Την Κυριακή, τα παιδιά πηγαίνουν εκδρομές. On Sunday, the kids go on excursions. Ο εκτυπωτής εκτυπώνει ένα έγγραφο. The printer is printing a document. Πήρε τηλέφωνο η γυναίκα. The woman called. Here are some more uses of the definite article. Number 1. Between a noun and the demonstrative pronouns αυτός, αυτή, αυτό. Ετούτος, ετούτη, ετούτο, and εκείνος, εκείνη, εκείνο. For example, αυτή η γυναίκα, this woman. Number 2. Between a noun and the adjectives όλος and ολόκληρος. For example, όλη η τάξη, the whole class, and ολόκληρος ο κόσμος, the whole world. However, ολόκληρος might not always require an article. For example, περιμένω ολόκληρες ώρες, I've been waiting for hours. Number 3. With a noun denoting something very specific followed by a possessive pronoun. For example, το βιβλίο μου, my book. Number 4. When talking about a rate. For example, 5 ώρες την ημέρα, 5 hours per day. Number 5. In sequences of nouns. For example, οι άντρες και οι γυναίκες, the men and women. Number 6. With abstract nouns, nouns denoting substances, and with nouns and adjectives in the plural when they denote a very specific entity. For example, η υπομονή είναι χρυσός. Patience is gold. Το ξύλο καίγεται εύκολα. Wood burns easily. And τα παιδιά είναι το μέλλον. Children are the future. Number 7. When we want to treat as a noun a different type of word or even a whole phrase. In that case, we use the neuter article. For example, τι θα φέρει το αύριο? What will tomorrow bring? Ποια είναι η σημασία του βλέπω? What's the meaning of to see? And το ότι καπνίζεις με απογοητεύει. The fact that you smoke disappoints me. Finally, let's see some cases where you don't need a definite article. The most common cases are with the subject or object of a sentence, when we are talking about it generally, or when we don't want to define it as something or someone specific. For example, υπάρχει περίπτωση ανθρώπου που γύρισε στη ζωή. There is a case of a man that came back to life. And πήρα αυτοκίνητο. I bought a car. Next, in predicates, when we give an attribute to something or someone. Predicates are connected with the subject through a linking verb, like the verb to be. For example, αυτή είναι δασκάλα. She is a teacher. Finally, in similes, after σαν, meaning as or like. For example, ψηλός σαν κυπαρίσι, tall like a cypress tree. No article is also used when talking about items or substances that have no specific amount. For example, το μωρό θέλει γάλα. The baby wants some milk. Here are some sample sentences. Ο γιος μου έγινε γιατρός. My son became a doctor. Πήρα προαγωγή. I got a promotion. It takes some time to get comfortable with all the uses of articles, as they might be affected by other parts of speech, such as prepositions. But I think the points I mentioned are the most basic and important ones to keep in mind when you are just starting to learn Greek. How was the lesson? Pretty interesting, right? Do you have any more questions? Leave them in the comments below and I'll try to answer them. Γεια χαρά!
Learning a language requires a huge investment of time and often money as well. Many people are hesitant to put in the amount of effort required to become fluent. But learning a new language can be one of life's most rewarding experiences. Here are 5 reasons to learn a language. Number 1. More opportunities. A new language can open up many new doors. You're able to work in countries other than your own. Tons of employers look to hire multilingual professionals every year. Number 2. Meeting new people. Get to know speakers of other languages on a more personal level. Meeting new people is one of the main reasons people begin to study a language. Making new friends is a good enough reason to start studying. Number 3. Exploring a different culture. Whether you decide to live abroad or you're just taking a vacation, knowing the local language will allow you to better understand the people. This can open your eyes to not only their country, but your country as well. Learn how people view your home from their perspective. Number 4. Health benefits. Studying a new language actually comes with health benefits. Keep your brain sharp by studying every day. You'll be helping your mind fight off old age and stay fresh. Number 5. Discover you can do it. We've heard every excuse that people give for failing to learn a new language. Too old, not enough time, wrong genes. But you shouldn't let your excuses hold you back. You really can learn another language. You could even hold your first conversation just a few days from now. Don't make any more excuses. Just click to start speaking the language you've always wanted to learn. Sign up for your free lifetime account. No credit card required, and you'll get the best free online resources. Stop hesitating and start learning a new language now.
Γεια σας, είμαι η Στεφανία. Η απόκριση στην Ελλάδα είναι μια περίοδος γλεντιού, ψυχαγωγίας και μασκαρέματος. Η ατμόσφαιρα είναι κεφάτη, με πολλά πάρτι μασκέ, πειράγματα και καρναβάλια που λαμβάνουν χώρα σε διάφορες περιοχές της Ελλάδας. Οι απόκριες διαρκούν 3 εβδομάδες και γιορτάζονται 70 ημέρες πριν το Πάσχα, κατά τον Φεβρουάριο ή τον Μάρτιο. Σε αυτό το βίντεο θα μάθετε πληροφορίες σχετικά με την ιστορία αλλά και τα έθιμα της περίοδου των απόκριων. Μήπως γνωρίζετε τι ακριβώς σημαίνει η λέξη καρναβάλι και από πού προέρχεται? Θα σας δείξουμε την απάντηση στο τέλος αυτού του βίντεο. Με τις απόκριες ανοίγει επίσημα το Τριώδιο. Μια περίοδος που έχει σκοπό να μας προετοιμάσει με νηστεία, προσευχή και μετάνοια για να υποδεχτούμε το Πάσχα και την Ανάσταση του Ιησού Χριστού. Οι 3 εβδομάδες των αποκριών ονομάζονται προφωνή, κρεατινή και τυρινή ή τη στυροφάγου. Η κρεατινή εβδομάδα τελειώνει με την Κυριακή της Απόκριο, διότι από την επόμενη μέρα κάνουμε αποχή από το κρέας. Έξω και η λέξη απόκριες. Την εβδομάδα της στυροφάγου τρώμε γαλακτοκομικά προϊόντα ως ενδιάμεση κατάσταση μεταξύ της κρεοφαγίας και της νηστείας που θα ακολουθήσει κατά την επόμενη περίοδο αυτή της Σαρακοστής. Οι απόκριες όμως συνδέονται και με αρχές παγανιστικές εκδηλώσεις και κυρίως με την λατρεία του θεού Διονύσου, ο οποίος ξαναγεννιόταν για να φέρει την άνοιξη. Σήμερα, τα αποκριάτικα έθιμα της επαρχίας δείχνουν τις βαθύτερες αυτές ρίζες με ζωόμορφες μεταμφιέσεις που θυμίζουν κυρίως τράγους και μεγάλα κουδούνια που ξορκίζουν το κακό με εκοφαντικούς θορύβους. Ένα γνωστό έθιμο είναι οι γενίτσαροι και μπούλες της Νάουσας, που γυρίζουν τους δρόμους χορεύοντας με συγκεκριμένα βήματα, φορώντας ιδιόμορφες μάσκες που λέγονται πρόσωποι. Οι μπούλες είναι άντρες ντυμένοι γυναικεία, ενώ οι γενίτσαροι φορούν φουστανέλες. Στις μεγάλες πόλεις διοργανώνονται καρναβάλια με πιο γνωστό αυτό της Πάτρας. Άλλα γνωστά είναι το καρναβάλι της Ξάνθης και του Μοσχάτου στην Αθήνα. Το πατρινό καρναβάλι περιλαμβάνει εκδηλώσεις όπως χορούς, παρελάσεις, κυνήγι κρυμμένου θησαυρού, καρναβάλι των μικρών και άλλες. Κορυφώνεται το τελευταίο Σαββατοκύριακο της Αποκριάς με τη νυχτερινή παρέλαση πληρωμάτων και αρμάτων και με το τελετουργικό κάψιμο του βασιλιά Καρνάβαλου στο μόλο του Αγίου Νικολάου στο λιμάνι. Τα κουστούμια των συμμετεχόντων και τα άρματα είναι ιδιαίτερα εφάνταστα και μερικές φορές σατυρικά. Γενικά, κατά τις απόκριες, οι άνθρωποι τριγυρνούν στους δρόμους μεταμφιεσμένοι, ρίχνοντας σερπαντίνες, κομφετί και πειράζοντας ο ένας τον άλλον. Στην περιοχή της Πλάκας όμως, στην Αθήνα, αν δείτε πιτσιρικάδες με πλαστικά ρόπαλα, θα σας ρίξουν δυνατές ροπαλιές. Γι' αυτό, προσοχή! Και τώρα θα σας δείξω την απάντηση του προηγούμενου quiz. Μήπως γνωρίζετε τι ακριβώς σημαίνει η λέξη καρναβάλι και από πού προέρχεται? Η λέξη καρναβάλι προέρχεται από το λατινικό carne levare, που όπως και η λέξη από κρυά, σημαίνει αποχή από το κρέας. Μερικοί ειδικοί όμως πιστεύουν ότι προήλθε από το επίσης λατινικό carus navalis, που σημαίνει ναυτικό αμαξίδιο. Η πρώτη άποψη υποστηρίζει την χριστιανική προέλευση του όρου, ενώ η δεύτερη μια πιο παγανιστική. Πώς σας φάνηκε το μάθημα αυτό? Μάθατε τίποτα ενδιαφέρον? Αν είχατε την ευκαιρία να βρεθείτε σε ένα ελληνικό καρναβάλι, τι θα ντυνόσασταν? Αφήστε μας τα σχόλιά σας στο GreekPod101.com και τα λέμε στο επόμενο μάθημα. Γεια χαρά!
Hi everybody, Stefania here. Welcome to Ask a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Greek questions. The question for this lesson is, when do you keep the final ni of a word? Many students get confused when they see some Greek words that end in ni, sometimes omitting that final ni. For example, then and the, not. Mean and me, don't. Din and ti, the. And so on. So they ask me why this happens. I will explain the rule behind this in hopes that it will help all of you puzzled learners of Greek. Let's go into more detail. First, let's see what does the final ni rule say and which words get affected by it. The rule says that the feminine words din, the or her, stin, to the, aftin, her, and the particles then and mean keep that final ni when the next word begins either with a vowel or the consonants kappa, p, taf, xi, psi, or the double consonant combinations b, d, g, ts, and z. In any other case, they lose it. Min also loses its final ni before a punctuation mark or a scholarly participle in some standard expressions. For example, mi, don't, and choros mi kapnizondon, non-smoking area. The masculine words ton, the, or him, ston, to, in, or, at the, enon, one, afton, him, and the adverb san, as or like, always keep that final ni. This rule applies to written speech only. In oral speech, many Greeks assimilate the final ni with the next word's initial letter, so ni is often not heard. Check out our assimilation videos in the Ultimate Greek Pronunciation Guide series on GreekPod101.com. Here are some sample sentences. Αυτόν δεν τον ξέρω, I don't know him. Χρησιμοποιώ τη σκούπα, I use the broom. Following up, let's see why we keep the final ni in some words. The reason is simple. If we were to remove the final ni from the masculine words ton, ston, afton, and enan, they could be confused for neuter words, especially when they define a noun whose gender we are not sure of. So, when we would see somewhere written toneo, without knowing the context, we wouldn't be sure if it's a neuter adjective, meaning the new, or a masculine noun in the accusative case, meaning ton neo, the young man. Here are some more sample sentences. Ξέρεις τον νέο υπάλληλο? Do you know the new employee? Διαλέγω αυτόν και εκείνον. I choose him and him. Finally, there is one case where the current rule creates some uncertainty. By allowing us to write the, not, there might be cases where this negative particle might be mistaken for the conjunction the, roughly meaning however. For example, ο δάσκαλος μιλούσε, οι μαθητές δε γελούσαν. The teacher was talking, the students, however, were laughing. If the conjunction the would be mistaken for the verb's negation when reading, then the meaning would be different. The teacher was talking, the students weren't laughing. The problem is in written speech only, because in oral speech, the intonation helps make the distinction. This issue has created a lot of controversy among teachers, editors, and linguists, leaving students and other people confused. So some Greeks write then, always, while others follow the existing rule. I personally choose to always write then to avoid any confusion. Here are some sample sentences. Πρώτα γίνεται η συνέντευξη, κατόπιν δε γίνεται εξέταση. First, there's the interview. Later on, however, there's an examination. Δεν ξέρω τι να κάνω. I don't know what to do. Tip. If you have trouble remembering the rule's consonant letters, here's a cheat phrase that will help you remember them. Τσάι στην κατάψυξη και ένα μπουλντόγ στο τζιπ. Meaning, tea in the freezer and a bulldog in the jeep. I know it sounds ridiculous, but I hope this cheap phrase will help. How was the lesson? Pretty interesting, right? Do you have any more questions? If you can come up with any other cheat ideas, let me know in the comments. Γεια χαρά!
To master a new language and understand everything as soon as you hear it, to read with just a quick glance and speak smoothly without thinking, you need to review. Here are our top 5 review tactics. Number 1. Listen to examples over and over again. By listening closely and often, you start to pick up the rhythm of a language, as well as correct pronunciation from a native speaker. Use our line-by-line feature that lets you both listen and read along. Use this tool to practice as much as possible. Number 2. Use our voice recording tool to master perfect pronunciation. Record yourself and compare it against the native speaker. If you sound different, then repeat after the native speaker until you're able to match them. Use our voice recording feature, which makes recording super easy. Number 3. Master your recorded conversations. Record conversations and go over them again and again. Master entire conversations and repeat them line by line. Use any of the dialogues available for download on our website. These come with transcripts of the entire conversation. Number 4. Use mobile devices to reinforce previously learned conversations. Constant review is the best way to progress in your language studies. Download the recorded dialogue to your mobile device and incorporate it into your music playlist. Quick reviews throughout the day effectively reinforce what you've learned. Number 5. Read with line-by-line notes. Read along with a native speaker to really master pronunciation and natural intonation. You should start slow at first, then slowly increase your speed. Your pronunciation will become more natural. You will also see that your ability to understand fluent speakers will greatly increase. You'll be able to improve your communication skills using these 5 simple review techniques. Increase your understanding of your target language. And remember, if you're interested in getting all these review tools, sign up for your free lifetime account. No credit card required, and you'll get the best free online resources. And start reviewing more every day.
Hi everyone, Stefania here. Do you have any language learning goals for this year? I hope you do if you really want to learn Greek. But if you don't, this video is here for you. So let's see. What are your top 10 language learning goals for the year? Θα ολοκληρώσω τη σειρά survival phrases στο GreekPod101.com με το να ακούω δύο μαθήματα την ημέρα. I'll finish Survival Phrases series on GreekPod101.com by listening to 2 lessons a day. Θα ολοκληρώσω τη σειρά Survival Phrases στο GreekPod101.com με το να ακούω δύο μαθήματα την ημέρα. I'll finish Survival Phrases series on GreekPod101.com by listening to 2 lessons a day. Actually, 2 lessons a day is pretty good. You learn lots of useful phrases in a very short time. Θα τελειώσω το διάβασμα ενός ελληνικού βιβλίου διαβάζοντας 10 σελίδες την ημέρα. I'll finish reading one Greek book by reading 10 pages a day. Θα τελειώσω το διάβασμα ενός ελληνικού βιβλίου διαβάζοντας 10 σελίδες την ημέρα. I'll finish reading one Greek book by reading 10 pages a day. Not one, not two, but 10 pages a day. If you can do that, I'll salute you. Θα περάσω το τεστ ελληνικών μου. I'll pass my Greek test. Θα περάσω το τεστ ελληνικών μου. I'll pass my Greek test. Talking about Greek tests, if you are interested in obtaining an official certificate to prove your Greek knowledge to yourself or to the world, you should aim for the so-called Certificate of Attainment in Greek. This certificate is established by the Greek Ministry of Education, so it's as official as it gets. Anything else is not officially recognized in Greece. If you are outside of Greece and want to do the examination, you should ask your local Greek embassy to see if they have information on local examination centers. Θα κάνω μια τρίλεπτη ομιλία παρουσίαση στα ελληνικά για τους Έλληνες φίλους μου. I'll give a 3-minute introductory speech in Greek to my Greek friends. Θα κάνω μια τρίλεπτη ομιλία παρουσίασης στα ελληνικά για τους Έλληνες φίλους μου. I'll give a 3-minute introductory speech in Greek to my Greek friends. 3 minutes might sound like not too much time, but it's actually quite a lot if you have to talk about yourself all the time. Θα αποστηθήσω 5 ελληνικά τραγούδια. I'll memorize 5 Greek songs. Θα αποστηθήσω 5 ελληνικά τραγούδια. I'll memorize 5 Greek songs. That's only if Greek music is a thing for you. The most popular Greek music genres are laiko, endechno and rebetiko. Θα αποστηθήσω 350 λέξεις με τα flashcards στο GreekPod101.com. I'll finish memorizing 350 words with flashcards on GreekPod101.com. Θα αποστηθήσω 350 λέξεις με τα flashcards στο GreekPod101.com. I'll finish memorizing 350 words with flashcards on GreekPod101.com. 350 words. You know what? Why not make it 365? One word for each day of the year. Θα γράψω στα ελληνικά 10 card postal για τους Έλληνες φίλους μου. I'll write 10 postcards in Greek to my Greek friends. Θα γράψω στα ελληνικά 10 card postal για τους Έλληνες φίλους μου. I'll write 10 postcards in Greek to my Greek friends. If you don't have that many Greek friends, this goal is a good chance to start making some. In Greece we say «Παντού υπάρχει ένας Έλληνας» and «Όποια πέτρα κι αν σηκώσεις, έναν Έλληνα θα βρεις από κάτω». It means that wherever you go and whichever stone you lift, you'll always find a Greek. And from my experience, it's true. There are Greeks even in the most faraway countries you can imagine. Θα μάθω να μιλάω για παρελθοντικά, παροντικά και μελλοντικά γεγονότα. I'll learn how to talk about past, present and future events. Θα μάθω να μιλάω για παρελθοντικά, παροντικά και μελλοντικά γεγονότα. I learned how to talk about past, present and future events. Like, who am I? Where do I come from? Where am I going? Very philosophical. Moving on. Θα μάθω πολύ καλά 150 λέξεις με το να αποστηθίζω 5 λέξεις την ημέρα. I'll master 150 words by memorizing 5 words a day. Θα μάθω πολύ καλά 150 λέξεις με το να αποστηθίζω 5 λέξεις την ημέρα. I'll master 150 words by memorizing 5 words a day. So basically, 150 words in a month. Just make sure to learn not just nouns, but other useful words too, like verbs, adjectives, and pronouns, so you can create complete sentences. You don't want to sound like, meet Tarzan, you Jane. You want to be more like, hello, I'm Tarzan. Hello, I'm Jane. Nice to meet you, Jane. Here to jump on my back and go for a crazy ride around the jungle? Θα δώσω εξετάσεις για την πιστοποίηση ελληνομάθειας. I will take examinations for the state certificate of attainment in modern Greek. Θα δώσω εξετάσεις για την πιστοποίηση ελληνομάθειας. I will take examinations for the state certificate of attainment in modern Greek. If this is your goal, I really hope you'll pass that examination. It's a great achievement, and I'm sure you can do it. Just gotta focus on your goal and keep studying hard. And this is the end for this video. What are your language goals for this year? Leave me a comment, and if you like what you saw, give it a thumbs up, subscribe, and stay tuned on GreekPod101.com for more videos like this. Γεια χαρά!
Hi everybody, Stefania here. Welcome to Ask a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Greek questions. The question for this lesson is, when should you use the nominative case? In everyday life, we see the nominative case, or onomastiki ptosi in Greek, being used in dictionary and encyclopedia entries, listed items, and city names on street signs. But grammatically speaking, the nominative case in speech is used in 3 cases. Firstly, in the subject of a clause or sentence. Secondly, in the predicate of a subject. Thirdly, after some prepositions. This is the least common use of the nominative case. Let's go into more detail. First, let's see the first case, the nominative case in a subject. The subject of a clause or sentence answers the question who or what, or in Greek ποιος, ποια, ποιο, τι, and is always in the nominative case. For example, ο άνθρωπος είναι άρρωστος. Ποιος είναι άρρωστος, ο άνθρωπος. The man is sick. Who is sick? The man. Another example is το σπίτι έχει 2 πνοδομάτια. Τι έχει 2 πνοδομάτια? Το σπίτι. The house has 2 bedrooms. What has 2 bedrooms? The house. Here are some more sample sentences. Ο Πέτρος είναι γιατρός. Peter is a doctor. Το τηλέφωνο χτυπάει. The phone is ringing. Following up, we have the nominative case being used in the predicate of a subject. The predicate of a subject in Greek is the part of a clause or sentence that is linked with the subject through a copular verb, also called a linking verb. The predicate of a subject always indicates a certain attribute the subject has, and in Greek it can be a noun, an adjective, a pronoun, a numeral, a passive voice participle, or even a whole phrase. If the predicate is a declinable word, then it is in the nominative case, although there may be some exceptions. Let's look again at the previous example. Ο άνθρωπος είναι άρρωστος. Τι είναι άρρωστος? The man is sick. What is he? Sick. Copular verbs in Greek are verbs of existence, such as είμαι, to be, γίνομαι, to become, υπάρχω, to exist, γεννιέμαι, to be born, πεθαίνω, to die, but also verbs such as φαίνομαι, to seem or to look, εκλέγομαι, to be elected, θεωρούμαι, to be considered, λέγομαι, or ονομάζομαι, to be called, and more. They come together with a predicate instead of an object because they are not transitive verbs. They just connect the subject of the verb to additional information about the subject. But having a copular verb in a sentence doesn't mean there will always be a subject predicate. For example, ο άνθρωπος είναι στο σπίτι. The man is in the house. The part in the house is a prepositional phrase expressing location. Its use is adverbial. It does not give the subject a special attribute, therefore, it is not the subject's predicate. Here are some other sample sentences with copular verbs and predicates. Έγινα πατέρας. I became a father. Υπάρχει ένας ποταμός εδώ κοντά. There is a river nearby. Finally, we have the nominative case after prepositions. Most prepositions in Greek are combined with words in the accusative case and some with words in the genitive. But in some rare cases, the nominative might be used as well, especially after prepositions such as apo, from, and di, instead, and ya, for. For example, έγινε από διευθυντής πρόεδρος. From a manager, he became a president. Αντί η Γιάννα να πάει βασιλική. Instead of Joanna, let βασιλική go. And περνιέσαι για έξυπνος. You think you are smart? Also in arithmetic, we use the preposition syn plus, πλην or μείον minus, επί times, and διά divided by with nominative. For example, πέντε μήλα συν τρία πορτοκάλια. 5 apples plus 3 oranges. Here are some more sample sentences with the nominative case after prepositions. Έγινε από δήμαρχος κλητήρας. From a mayor, he became a clerk. Δεν φαίνεται για δικηγόρος. He doesn't look like a lawyer. How was the lesson? Pretty interesting, right? Do you have any more questions? Leave them in the comments below and I'll try to answer them. Γεια χαρά!
You are at a bus terminal where you are waiting for your bus. There's a notice posted at the bus stop about a new bus route that will be introduced next year. What is the main advantage of this new bus route? What is the main advantage of this new bus route? The introduction of the new bus will ease the congestion on the buses of the 301 line.
Το νέο λεωφορείο θα βοηθήσει στην αποσυμφόρηση των λεωφορείων της γραμμής 301.
Hi everybody, Stefania here. Welcome to Ask a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Greek questions. The question for this lesson is, what are the most common uses of the genitive case? In everyday life, we see the genitive case being used for female last names, in names of some areas, and in most street names when the latter two are named after someone or something. However, grammatically speaking, the genitive case in speech is used in many ways, some of which are as a direct or indirect object, or as an adverbial determiner completing the meaning of a verb, as a nominal determiner completing the meaning of a noun or an adjective, after some prepositions and adverbs. Let's go into more detail. First, let's see the genitive case as a direct and indirect object. Usually, direct objects in Greek are in the accusative case, and indirect objects are in the genitive. However, some verbs require a direct object in the genitive. Such verbs are verbs of expression like απευθύνομαι, to address, γνέφω, to wave, nod, εξομολογούμε, to confess, λέω, to say, μιλάω, to talk, and χαμογελώ, to smile. Verbs of sensations like αρέσω, to like, βρωμάω, to stink, ξυνίζω, to be sour, and μυρίζω, to smell. Verbs of ownership like ανήκω, to belong, and βρίσκομαι, to have, normally meaning to be located. Verbs that denote an association like αναλογώ, to correspond, μοιάζω, to look like, ταιριάζω, to match. Verbs that denote modality like αξίζω, to deserve, and χρειάζομαι, to need. Another example is σου μιλάω, I'm talking to you. Σου here is the direct object of the verb in the genitive case. Now, when an object, direct or indirect, is in the genitive case, it usually answers the question σε ποιον, πιαν, ποιο, to whom, when we refer to the action of the verb. For example, η μαμά μου έδωσε το βιβλίο. Σε ποιον έδωσε το βιβλίο? Σε μένα, μου. Mom gave me the book. To whom did she give the book? To me. Here are some sample sentences with the genitive case as an object. Η κοπέλα αυτή της μοιάζει πολύ. This girl looks like her a lot. Μου δίνεις λίγο το μολύβι σου? Can you give me your pencil for a second? Following up, the genitive case can be a nominal or an adverbial determiner. When a noun in the genitive case defines a different noun or an adjective that is not in the genitive case, then the noun in genitive is what we call a nominal determiner in genitive. Such a determiner might denote a lot of things, such as ownership, location, time, property, reason, matter, content, measurement, purpose, something that is part of a bigger group, family relationship, a creator, a simile, origin, comparison, close relation, volition, who or what does or receives an action, and separation. For example, πήγα στο σπίτι της Θωμαΐς. I went to Θωμαΐς' house. The house belongs to Θωμαΐς. So here, the genitive expresses ownership. Next, when a genitive case defines a verb in an adverbial sense, it might indicate things such as time, reason, means, manner, and result. For example, θα επιστρέψει του χρόνου. He will come back next year. Here we are expressing time. Some related sample sentences are παρήγγειλα μια σαλάτα λαχανικών. I ordered a vegetable salad. And πεθαίνω της πείνας. I'm starving. Literally, dying of hunger. Next, the genitive case can be used after some prepositions and adverbs. The prepositions that are mostly combined with genitive, forming prepositional phrases, are some archaic ones, like anef, without, via, by means of, enandion, against, ektos, except, ek or ex, from, exetias or logo, due to, meso, through, metaxi, between, pro, before, and hyper, in favor of. Be careful as some other words might come between the preposition and the word in genitive. Prepositional phrases define a verb and indicate things such as location, time, reason, opposition, origin, means, exclusion, etc., depending on the meaning of the preposition and the context. For example, ψηφίζω εναντίον σου. I vote against you. Here, we are expressing opposition. Finally, sometimes an adverb may come before a word in the genitive case, indicating things such as location, time, manner, and separation. For example, θα είμαι πάντα κοντά σου. I will always be near you. Here, we are expressing location. Some other sample sentences are είσαι εκτός θέματος. You're off topic. And πετάει για Αμερική μέσω Λονδίνου. He flies to America via London. These were some of the most common uses of the genitive case. For more uses and examples, check out our grammar bank on GreekPod101.com. If you have any questions, leave me a comment. Γεια χαρά!
Today we're going to talk about four techniques to help you stop translating in your head and instead start thinking in your target language. This will allow you to have conversations with ease, read smoothly, and better understand native speakers. These are four methods to help you think in a new language. Number one, surround yourself with your target language. This way, you'll be completely immersed in the language. Without realizing it, you'll learn pronunciation, sentence structures, grammar, and new vocabulary. Play music in the background while you're cooking, or have a radio station on while you study. Just use one of our endless podcasts available to you. These are easy to listen to in the background while doing other things. Number two, learn through observation. This is how we all learned our native languages as kids. Words will develop their own meanings that relate better to your target language, rather than meanings that are translated directly. Number three, speak out loud to yourself. Even if you're a little embarrassed, it forces you to listen to how you speak. It makes it much easier to spot simple grammar mistakes. Number four, practice daily. If you practice everything for only one day, you won't retain the information you learned. The brain can realistically only focus for about 30 minutes.
So studying a little every day allows you to absorb better. Follow these steps and have patience. You'll soon be able to achieve your language learning goals. Just make sure to remember these four methods. Sign up for your free lifetime account. No credit card required, and you'll get the best free online resources. And start learning more every day.
Γεια σας, είμαι η Στεφανία. Τα Θεοφάνεια, ή αλλιώς τα Φώτα, είναι μια χριστιανική εορτή που γιορτάζεται κάθε χρόνο στις 6 Ιανουαρίου, εις ανάμνηση της βάπτισης του Ιησού Χριστού από τον Άγιο Ιωάννη τον Βαπτιστή στον Ιορδάνη ποταμό. Είναι η τρίτη και η τελευταία εορτή του 12ημέρου, της περίοδου δηλαδή από τα Χριστούγεννα ως τα Θεοφάνεια. Λέγεται 12ήμερο επειδή διαρκεί 12 ημέρες. Σε αυτό το βίντεο θα μάθετε πώς ακριβώς γιορτάζονται τα Θεοφάνεια στην Ελλάδα. Η σύνθετη λέξη Θεοφάνεια αποτελείται από δύο λέξεις. Μήπως γνωρίζετε ποιες είναι αυτές? Θα σας δείξουμε την απάντηση στο τέλος αυτού του βίντεο. Σύμφωνα με τις γραφές, κάποια ημέρα ο Ιησούς παρουσιάστηκε στον Ιωάννη τον Βαπτιστή, που κήρυτε και βάπτιζε στον Ιορδάνη ποταμό, ζητώντας τον να βαπτιστεί. Κατά τη στιγμή της βάπτισης, κατέβηκε από τον ουρανό το Άγιο Πνεύμα υπό μορφή περιστεράς. Στάθηκε πάνω από τον Ιησού, ενώ ταυτόχρονα ακούστηκε η φωνή του Θεού από τον ουρανό. Φανερώθηκε έτσι στη γη η Αγία Τριάδα. Πάνω σε αυτό το γεγονός καθιερώθηκε από την Εκκλησία το μυστήριο του βαπτίσματος με την χρήση νερού. Την ημέρα των Θεοφανίων, στις παραθαλάσσιες περιοχές της Ελλάδας, τελείται το έθιμο του αγιασμού των υδάτων, κάτι που θυμίζει την βάπτιση του Ιησού. Κατά την τελετή, που λέγεται και απλά αγιασμός, καθαγιάζονται τα ύδατα με ευχές και επικλήσεις του ιερέα, καθώς και με την εμβάπτιση του Τιμίου Σταυρού στα νερά. Σε περιοχές μη παραθαλάσσιες, η τελετή μπορεί να γίνει σε ποτάμι, λίμνη ή και σε δεξαμενή νερού. Αγιασμοί τελούνται επίσης σε σπίτια, όπου ο ιερέας, με ένα κλαδί βασιλικού, ραντίζει το σπίτι με το αγιασμένο νερό. Κατά την εμβάπτιση του Τιμίου Σταυρού σε θάλασσα, ποτάμι, λίμνη ή δεξαμενή, τολμηροί κολυμβητές ή αλλιώς βουτυχτάδες βουτούν στα παγωμένα νερά για να τον ανασύρουν. Όποιος πιάσει τον Σταυρό, αφού πρώτα τον φιλήσει, τον περιφέρει στις οικίες και λαμβάνει πλούσια δώρα. Στην ελληνική ταινία Μανταλένα, που γυρίστηκε στην Αντίπαρο το 1960, γίνεται μια χαρακτηριστική απόδοση του εθίμου αυτού, αν και ο λίγο κωμικοτραγική. Άλλα έθιμα των Θεοφανίων είναι τα κάλαντα των φώτων, που λένε τα παιδιά την παραμονή της εορτής, και το πλήσιμο των εικόνων. Θυμάστε τους καλικάτζαρους, τους δαίμονες που ανεβαίνουν στη γη την παραμονή των Χριστουγέννων? Με τους αγιασμούς των Θεοφανίων φοβούνται, τρέπονται σε φυγή και επιστρέφουν ξανά στην υπόγεια κρυψώνα τους, όπου και παραμένουν μέχρι την επόμενη παραμονή Χριστουγέννων. Και τώρα θα σας δείξω την απάντηση του προηγούμενου quiz. Η σύνθετη λέξη Θεοφάνεια αποτελείται από δύο λέξεις. Μήπως γνωρίζετε ποιες είναι αυτές? Η λέξη Θεοφάνεια αποτελείται από τη λέξη Θεός και από το αρχαίο ρήμα φαίνω, που σημαίνει φανερώνω. Η γιορτή ονομάζεται έτσι επειδή, όπως είδαμε, ο Θεός φανερώθηκε στη γη. Λέξεις όπως φαίνομαι, φαινόμενο, φαντασία, φάντασμα, φανάρι παράγονται από το ρήμα φαίνω. Πώς σας φάνηκε το μάθημα αυτό? Μάθατε τίποτα ενδιαφέρον? Εσείς έχετε δει ποτέ ζωντανά ή σε βίντεο την τελετή αγιασμού των υδάτων? Αφήστε μας τα σχόλιά σας στο GreekPod101.com και τα λέμε στο επόμενο μάθημα. Γεια χαρά!
Hi everybody, Stefania here. Welcome to Ask a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Greek questions. The question for this lesson is, when should you use the accusative case? In grammar, the accusative case is used in the following ways. First, to complete the meaning of a verb, either as a direct object, which is the most common use, less commonly as an indirect object, or as an adverbial determiner. Second, the accusative case can be used to complete the meaning of a noun or an adjective as a nominal determiner. And third, some prepositions may be followed by a word in accusative. Let's go into more detail. First, let's see the accusative case completing the meaning of a verb as an object. When an object, direct or indirect, is in the accusative case, it usually answers the question whom, pion, pian, pio, or what, ti,
when we refer to the action of the verb. For example, έχω έναν μαρκαδόρο. Τι έχω? Έναν μαρκαδόρο. I have a marker. What do I have? A marker. Here, the accusative έναν μαρκαδόρο is the direct object. Ακούω τη δασκάλα. Ποιαν ακούω? Τη δασκάλα. I listen to the teacher. Whom do I listen to? The teacher. The accusative τη δασκάλα is the direct object. Here are some more sample sentences. Συμπληρώστε τη φόρμα, παρακαλώ. Fill in the form, please. Έβαψα όλους τους τοίχους. I painted all the walls. Next, an accusative can define a verb in an adverbial sense, indicating things such as time, location, duration, manner, amount, reason, and purpose. For example, το μωρό κοιμάται την ημέρα. The baby sleeps during the day. Here the accusative την ημέρα expresses time, answering the question of when. Following that, the accusative case can be a nominal determiner completing the meaning of a noun or an adjective. Although rare, this happens when a noun in the accusative case defines a different noun or an adjective. The noun in the accusative then might denote the following things. Number 1. Reference. Το δωμάτιο είχε 4 μέτρα μήκος. The room was 4 meters long, in reference to the length. This happens usually with words such as μάκρος or μήκος, length, πλάτος, width, βάθος, depth, and ύψος, height. Number 2. Measurement. Πήδηξε έναν τοίχο 2 μέτρα. He jumped a 2-meter wall. Number 3. Content. Έπεσε σε ένα λάκκο γεμάτο λάσπες. He fell in a puddle full of mud. This happens usually when the adjectives γεμάτος, full of, and όλος, also meaning full of. Number 4. To whom or what an action goes, called objective accusative. Προσοχή τα χέρια σας. Mind your hands. This accusative, in this case τα χέρια, answers to what. So, mind what? Your hands. This happens usually with nouns coming from verbs that express a command, a wish, or exhortation. Here are some more sample sentences. Η πισίνα εδώ έχει 2 μέτρα βάθος. The pool here is 2 meters deep. Αγόρασα ένα σακί πατάτες. I bought a bag of potatoes. Finally, we use the accusative case after certain prepositions. The most common ones are από, from, με, with, σε, to, in, on, at, για, for, ανά, per, παρά, despite, ίσαμε, up to, πριν, before, σαν, as or like, ως or μέχρι, until, χωρίς or δίχως, without, προς, towards or to, μετά, after, and κατά, during. Note that σε always gets contracted in front of articles. For example, σε plus τον becomes στον. Prepositional phrases define a verb in an adverbial sense to indicate things such as location, time, reason, purpose, result, reference, condition, opposition, origin, amount, means, manner, escort, property, etc. For example, είμαι στην παραλία. I'm at the beach. Here, the prepositional phrase with accusative στην παραλία expresses location. Note that sometimes other words might come between the preposition and the word it defines. For example, το φόρεμα είναι από το μαγαζί της Σούλας. The dress is from Σούλας store. But changing the word order, we might get το φόρεμα είναι από τη Σούλα στο μαγαζί. So don't get confused. The prepositional phrase here is από plus το μαγαζί, although τισούλας in genitive comes in between. Here are some more sample sentences. Η κόρη μου σπουδάζει στην Αμερική. My daughter is studying in the US. Αυτό είναι για εκείνον. This is for him. How was the lesson? Pretty interesting, right? If you would like to learn more about the accusative case, as well as take a look at some more examples, check out our grammar bank on GreekPod101.com. And if you have any questions, leave me a comment. Γεια χαρά!